History Hound presents Newmarket Oral History.
Good afternoon. I'm about to talk to an old friend of mine and a neighbor, Margaret Davis, and she's got a few things to say about the town of Newmarket over the years and about their family growing up here. So, Margaret, welcome.
Good afternoon, Jack. This is a pleasure to be speaking to you because I know you so well since you were four. And in 1946, my husband, Keith Davis, was demobbed from the Air Force after 6 years. And we had to find a place to live and he had to find a job. Keith was born in Aurora and had knew Newmarket really well. He had worked in the bank before the war on the main street at the Imperial Bank in Newmarket and had a lot of friends here. So looking for a house, he tried Aurora where he was born and had relatives, but there was nothing available. And during the war, there had been no new building and housing was very scarce. So we came to Newmarket, and Keith talked to an old friend, Norm Matthews, who was a prominent lawyer in town and had been playing in tennis years before.
Yeah.
So anyhow, he said, well, I think I know that Mr. Bogue, who is the registrar, I think he bought a house, he said, up on Warren Avenue. And he was hoping that his son, Max, would come to live in Newmarket after the war, and he got back the war. However, Max apparently wasn't interested in the house. And Norm Matthews said, well, I think he might, you know, rent it to you, because we weren't prepared to buy anything at that moment. And so the wartime prices and trade board at that time, you had to, you couldn't keep a house empty for longer than 9 months.
Okay.
So that worked out really well. So we rented the house from him. And then Keith, he got a job at the Hoffman Machinery Company as a purchasing agent. And we were all set that way.
Good.
And we just, Keith's first interest, though, was to run down to the tennis courts to see how they were, how they survived the war. Well, they really hadn't. They were all grown, they were clay, and they were all grown up in weeds, except the first one was sort of playable. But there was a padlock on the door, apparently, on the gate. They didn't want the kids to get in and ride their bikes around in there or anything. So he got the lock off the door, and then we started working away on the courts and cleaning them up with the help of a few local people. And
that'd be a big job.
It was awfully hard work with that grass. And we noticed that after the place was all set and ready to go, all these people popped out from nowhere, all set to play.
Wow.
It just seems to be, you know, there's certain types of people that really want to help.
Wow.
So Keith taught the kids, you know, for 27 years he taught lessons.
I was one of those kids, and our whole family came down,
right.
Actually.
That yeah.
was neat.
And are still playing.
Yes.
And it's certainly a nice sport. You can last for ages. He quit playing when he was 87, I think.
Wow.
And went back to golf. So.
Well, I remember going to see him play, and mm-hmm. it was a pleasure to watch him play. Mm-hmm. And when he had his other people with him, like mm-hmm. Charlie Lee.
Yes.
Different ones. They all played the same. Ken Peaver.
Yeah, Bob Yates. No,
Bob
there were
Yates,
some good
yes.
players.
Yes.
Yeah, they had a league with Barry and Richmond Hill and...
Oh.
Met Penetang, I think, in Midland. Yeah, okay. We had a great time. And I used to take the kids around to tournaments in Toronto. We had a station wagon and we'd pile them in and even we took them to London, to the Western Ontario Open and to Canadian Open in Ottawa, the Rideau Club.
Okay.
So it was a lot of fun with
the
kids.
You took me down to the beaches, I think I remember that.
Yeah,
somewhere
that would
there.
Be the Telly tournament.
Well, that was the Telly tournament. Okay. Never forget it.
The owner of the Telegram, he was a tennis player. So every year he sponsored this tournament with nice prizes for the kids.
All right.
But at that time, when you were a veteran, you had three choices. You could either university education, or mm-hmm. I think you could get 2 acres of land, or you could take money instead for how many ever days you served. You got a certain amount.
Okay.
So we used the money to put a down payment on the house.
Sure.
And at that time, the houses were just beginning to go up in price.
Oh.
And Mr. Bogue had bought this house for $3,000. And $3,500. It had been sold in 1892 for $3,000. And 50 years later, it had only gone up $500 in price after 50 years.
Incredible.
So said that Norm Matthews, the lawyer, said, now he'll ask you $5,000 for it, and you offer him $4,000, and you'll get it for $4,500. So that's what we did.
Oh, good advice.
Yeah, it really was.
Yes, good. I'll never forget your house.
Yeah, well, all the people that bought it from us absolutely loved it 25 years later. So, and it was so nice in those days for the children compared to today. You know, they were about 2 and 4 out running around.
Yeah.
The streets didn't go through.
Oh, yeah. It was
no, Millard was, it was all cut off at that corner.
Yeah, the farms right behind us.
Yeah.
That was good.
So they just went out. We never gave it a second thought about traffic much or anything. And that was really good. Now today it's so different.
Oh, totally.
You know, you can't let the kids out of your sight. So I noticed that was certainly good.
I think I married your daughter 3 or 4 times over the summer sometimes.
They
mock
were
weddings.
Playing these little games.
Yeah,
they had little marriage ceremonies.
And we made up a lot of our own activities up there, too.
Oh, you certainly did.
Monopoly took over some days.
Yeah, played a lot of Monopoly.
Yes.
And
good times.
We all went, you were at the Catholic school, but they used to have a Tom Kirk's night. I think he was the police chief, or maybe we just had the one.
Oh, Bill Hill?
This was maybe earlier.
Oh.
This Tom Kirk's night was a special night.
Yes.
He'd have for the kids, and the school kids all got down the arena and had races, and he supplied prizes and candies and stuff for the kids. He was really good. But another you mentioned.
Who supplied the prizes?
I think he did. He paid for the
who's that?
Evening. Tom Kirk.
Oh, he did?
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
okay. Yeah, it was called Tom Kirk's Night. Yeah.
Okay.
So then they had Bill Hill.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he was a very, very nice police chief, well respected. I think that was about 55 or so.
Okay. Yeah, okay.
In there.
55.
Yeah. And Keith got a job at Hoffman's as a purchasing agent. It was on Charles Street, an American firm. They made dry cleaning equipment.
Oh.
And, he was bored stiff there, but he worked there 7 years. But he really wanted to open up a sporting goods store.
Okay.
So, then it looked like Hoffman's wouldn't be around much longer. They were going back to the States, closing up. So he decided then to try and open a store. And we did. My mother-in-law gave us $500, and we spent $250 of it fixing up that little weeb store.
Oh.
It's behind the goulash store on Boxford Street.
Oh, yeah.
It's an extension of the, yeah.
But just off Main, yeah.
Yeah. So we were there, and Keith, the way he was going to keep us going, he always strung rackets over the years.
Okay.
And he had got a little contract with Dunlop Sporting Goods to string their rackets.
Okay.
So he got, the first week, he brought home 100 rackets, and he strung them all in a week, and he took them back. And his friend there, Bruce Morrow, he said, Keith, he said, I know the gym teacher at Alliston, Banding Memorial High School at Alliston.
Oh, yes.
And he said, you know, he'll need some stuff. You go over and see him.
Yeah.
And, you know, so Keith went over and got this big order for sporting goods. And he never really looked back. He never strung any rackets for a dollar after that. And then he started going to all the country schools all the way up.
Wow.
So he hit the road, and I just stayed and looked after the store.
That was a good move.
Yeah. Then Howard Bryce, who is our friend, he had the butcher store in town, and he said, you've got to get off that side street. You've got to get on the main street.
Okay.
And he said, I'll lend you some money, you know, to stock the store up if you want.
Yeah.
But we didn't seem to need it, so we didn't bother, but it was nice of him to mention it. And we sold sporting goods, toys, pet supplies, budgies. Budgies were a mistake.
Oh. I'd forgotten about the budgies.
Yeah, the guy told me, oh, it's just as easy to look after 12 as one. You know, the same cage and the water and everything. But what he forgot to tell me was that when the telephone rang, they'd be quiet, and the telephone rang. They all started chirping. And it was just unbelievable. Or if a customer came in, you couldn't hear yourself think.
Oh, okay.
So we had a great time with that.
That was temporary.
Yeah. And we didn't have that then too long. Then the parking was terrible, you know, even that,
on
you know,
Main
it was parking
Street.
Now, and it was parking then. And a lot of the store owners had the nasty little habit of parking in front of their own store. So,
crazy.
Yeah. And then they tried parking meters, and that didn't work out, because if you ever got a parking ticket, a meter, from a meter man, you never come back to Main Street again, you know.
Oh,
yeah. People didn't like that at all, so they had to have them.
Finally got rid
up.
Of those things. I remember those meters.
Mm-hmm. Then when I was, I'd be about 28, I been there about 4 years, I ran for the school board, and I have it.
No.
Oh, where is it? It's over there on that table, I guess.
Yeah, okay.
Mm-hmm. Anyhow, my just shows my ads for the paper. And my platform was the fact that when the kids, the first day of school, they came home with a long list, a list of all the stuff they required.
Yes.
You know, the pencils and paper and notebooks and things. And they'd all make a beeline for Elman Campbell's bookstore, the only place in town to buy the stuff. And the crush in there was unbelievable.
Big money coming through the door there.
And the kids were so excited.
Weren't they?
And there was a rumor that one kid had fainted in the crush.
Oh.
So that ran around town, a big event. And
so for the school board, you were going to push the...
Yeah, I thought that there are only about four schools, and I thought that they should buy the stuff in bulk and then just,
smart,
you know, have a little setup where they owned a certain school. She could just sell it to the kids, you know.
Direct.
Wholesale or whatever, yeah.
Good.
However, that apparently didn't move anybody, and the incumbent, J.L. Arbell, he returned to office and so on. They named a school after him. You know, he was about 50 years old at that time. He'd been around quite a while.
Okay.
And then Mrs. Bryce and I, Sally Bryce, which is that picture.
Right here.
Of us, yeah.
There we are.
We were put in the Hall of Fame. She died many years ago, but her daughter represented her. And
good.
About a year ago, we started the figure skating club, and it was a terrific response. All kinds of boys came and joined too, and we had skating carnivals. They were people, we didn't have reserve seats at the end of the year, and the people were just lined up all around the corner and up onto Main Street.
Not me.
And I know your fam, Pat, was in it, and your sister.
Maureen.
Maureen, she was one of the stars.
Oh.
And yeah, she was a terrific skater. And my husband and I had met him skating in Hyde Park in Toronto.
Oh.
And we both, you know, love skating. And so we took, you know, we joined in the skating lessons to help with the classes and so on. And so that organization is still going. It's about 68 years now.
There's, ongoing.
Yeah.
All that time.
And the tennis club is still going, and that's,
it's solid,
60 some years too.
And it's, that club is named after your husband.
Yes, yeah. The Keith Davis Tennis Center, they, the clubhouse is named after him.
Okay.
And yeah, or unfortunately they didn't do that till after he had died. He died about 18 years ago.
Okay.
So that was too bad. However, it's there, and it's, they planted a beautiful tree for him and everything.
Okay.
And the Main Street merchants, when business was slow, it was sort of a habit, some of us, a nice day, we'd stand outside the store and look up and down the street to see if there's any customers in sight. And Tom Surginer, he had the menswear store across the road from me, and one day I was standing there looking up the street, and he stepped out and he was doing the same thing. And then he called over and he said, "Well, I think I'll go up to Broadbent Bake Shop and get us some donuts. We might as well go down with a full stomach." So he did that. So that was,
wow,
you know, retailers.
Oh, that's, there's, it's tough times.
Yeah.
So good times, but some tough times.
Yeah. So we used to sell all these pet supplies and toys and stuff. But then the plaza opened, and you know, they had Woolworths, and it sold all the stuff we did.
Yes.
Gradually, after a year or two, it was going down.
This is on Davis Drive, almost to Yonge Street. Yes.
Yeah, on Parkside there.
Yes.
I think it is. So anyhow, I was just thinking, it went from the plaza, then the, oh yeah, in the meantime, a chap came in the store one day. It was Roy Keffer.
Oh.
And he said, "I'd like to buy a trophy." And I said, "Oh, we don't sell them, but Bob Yates does around the corner." And he said, "No, I don't want to buy one from Bob. Tell Keith to get me a trophy." So when Keith came in from his wanderings up and down the highway to the schools, I said, "Oh, you know, Roy wants a trophy." "Oh," he said, "I don't know where to get one," but anyhow, he got him one.
Oh.
And that was just fantastic, because we got into the trophy business.
Just like that.
Yeah, and the engraving.
Yes.
And the other business was going down the tube because all the country schools were closing.
Oh, I see.
And you know, making regional ones and so on.
Yes, amalgamation.
So, and the school board started ordering all their stuff in quantities, you know, and warehousing it themselves. I'd spend a couple of days, you know, making up tenders for stuff, and you know, it wasn't worth
it. That's a lot of work.
Yeah, so anyhow, that business went down the tube and the other, and then, so we had to adjust to, you know, the trophies.
Yeah.
And that was a good business because it's so fussy.
Yes.
You know, all the engraving, getting everything right. So we just concentrate on that. And now my grandson has the business. And that's about 63 years it's been in business.
Wow.
So that's good.
I remember all the stuff you used to order before Christmas.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
Just to have it all there. And if it was a good Christmas, that's great. But if you didn't have weather in line, whatever, make a difference in the sales.
So a person I was really interested in, and Keith knew him, was John Bowser.
Oh.
And, you
is
know,
this the
he,
architect? Or what?
Yeah, he was the construction superintendent, you know, for the Empire State Building. He was from Aurora.
Yes.
And he had a farm out Millard, that farmland out to the highway.
Yes.
And he had a wonderful herd of Black Angus cattle.
No.
But he wouldn't allow them down there in those fields because it was too wet. Remember, they used to have flooding in the when they did build houses on Millard down there. They got a lot of water.
They did.
Until they got the sewers going properly.
Yeah.
So he left home at 11. And
John Bowser did?
Yeah. And he came back, they said, when he was 15. I don't know what he was doing, but he started working on construction jobs.
Okay.
So he, I'd like to have something, you know, done on him.
We should.
Yeah. And when he built the interesting thing about him, when he told us one night he dropped in, and when he built the Empire State Building, there was quite all these construction workers, you can imagine, and a lot of them were a rough crowd. And, you know, if he carried a newspaper rolled up like that, like a roll up the Globe and Mail or something, not that long.
Okay.
And it was, and it was rolled up, it was as strong as a board. It would, you could, you know, if you did that to it, it was just like a piece of lumber.
Yes.
And he'd carry that around in his hand. And then if there were any altercations, if he had to, you know, intervene with some guys getting annoyed with each other, or if he had to tell somebody off and they didn't like it, well, he had this, you know.
Oh.
Yeah, and he said then if there was any questions later, he would just say, well, I just had a newspaper. I just hit him with a newspaper. Man. But he went to Tokyo.
Big stick.
He went to Tokyo to build those skyscrapers there.
Yes.
And they're still standing after all those years.
He's a natural.
All those are earthquakes.
Oh,
so
that,
he was a fabulous guy.
He had to be.
Yeah.
Wow.
And, but he packed up all his, you know, equipment for building and everything and took it over with them. But the Japanese wouldn't let him unload it because they wanted their labor. Manual labor to do this, and didn't want any of these machines doing something they couldn't do by hand.
Okay.
So he did that, and then he built the army camp in Newmarket.
He's the one that put that together.
They had a camp there for the army recruiting.
Six or 7 weeks to put that together. That was amazing at that time.
Apparently, he did it below cost and what they thought, and great time. And I know the they knocked some of the buildings down after, but they kept the drill hall. It's the curling club now, I think.
Yes.
And then those houses, the barracks, they divided them in half and moved them and built around them. And they're still there, people living very happily.
Quite happily.
In them.
Yes.
Yeah, he was a great guy. I think...
You've always been into sports all your life.
Yeah.
I remember you used to even go swimming every day for a long
time. Yeah, I went swimming a couple of times. This past week, I still go swimming.
Well, it's worth it.
Mm-hmm.
And you look great.
Oh, so well, thanks.
I'm sure that's part of it, in a way, right there.
Try to keep going, yeah.
You keep busy with bridge, duplicate?
Oh, bridge, yeah. About 30 years ago, we used to play duplicate bridge in Aurora.
Oh.
They had a nice club there, except the smoking got to be too much for us.
Oh.
Everybody was starting to complain.
Mm-hmm.
And anyhow, I wrote a letter to the executive, who were all smokers.
Oh.
We played four times a week.
Wow.
And I said, well, why don't we have two nights non-smoking and two nights they can smoke? Because I didn't want to police their smoking, telling them not to, you know, they were bothering us. So I sent this letter to the executive, and they had a meeting. And one of the girls on the executive, I said to her next time I saw her, what did they think of my letter? She said, what letter? They never even read it. So that did it.
That's it.
Came home, and we went over to the library and got the multi-purpose room there and started our own club in Newmarket. So 30 years I've been president of the club there.
Wow.
Heather's been the manager.
You were pretty close to that. I mean, you're just across the street, so you couldn't do much better.
In the winter, you know, they're trying to come in from here and there out around, and, you know, maybe it's too snowy to come.
Yep.
And I always say, well, I made it. It's here to the window away. And I was going to mention the Queen.
Yes. Queen Elizabeth. She's still...
Yeah.
Still active.
Anyhow, my nephew, Gene's son, Chris Goodwin, he has... he's got lots of money, and he's crazy about golf. And he built this wonderful golf course right in the middle of nowhere between London and St. Thomas. And it's called Red Tail. It's after the red tail hawks that fly over.
Yes.
And it's a world class, one of the best, we'll say one of the best in the world, maybe out of 100. I've seen write-ups about it. Anyhow, he's got this beautiful... well, a great big house on one side of the little lake, and his partner is on the other side. And when the Queen was coming to Canada in 1997, the palace had looked around, I guess, and said, wanted to have a place for her to have a respite, you know, 2 or 3 days.
Sure.
She was starting in Newfoundland and coming across to London, Ontario.
Yeah.
So they asked Chris if they could come and stay there for 2 or 3 days. So he said that would be fine. So all kinds of arrangements were made ahead, about 6 months ahead. So she arrived, and my sister and I, you know, Chris's mother, my sister,
yeah,
we were invited to come, and the original plan was, how's the time?
We're doing fine.
I mean, I don't want to go on too long.
Yeah.
Anyhow.
5 minutes.
Okay. So anyhow, she was invited. We were invited to go and have afternoon tea with the Queen at the court.
Yes.
At the clubhouse. So we were all set, and practically everybody in Newmarket and you heard we were going to meet the Queen. And then word came through from my nephew. It's been called off because the Queen, when she was in Newfoundland, they had been told not to have too many people there.
Yes.
And they invited more than they should have.
Yes.
And she got jostled. And she didn't like it.
No.
So she called.